And my kids used to laugh. I said, I hear something out there, but I'm joking, you know what I'm saying? But at that time, God came to me and he said, you want your children to see you take a hit of this and die just like that? He said, what you got to leave them? I can even speak of you. Well, my mother was a crackhead. She died. Nobody want to say that about their parent. But I was looking, I sit and I just looked around that room and I just went to look and I said, what am I doing? I said, now I got what I asked for, but now I'm not happy. I'm really lonely. I'm hurting inside. No one to understand where I'm coming from. You know, couldn't understand my feelings. No one to love me, no one to love back, you know. So he said, call your kids in here. Tell your kids you want help. I went and got my children, called them in there. But my son didn't accept that. That was the time, that's why I say about my relationship today, because back then I didn't have none. Even though I was in his house, but he didn't have the respect, he didn't believe. He said, I had to prove to him first. And that's the way he was, that's the way Elijah was at that time. But my daughter, even though I'd be wrong or right, she stood there. She said, you really want help? And I said, yeah. The last few little dollars I had, because I knew what she was going to do. You know what I'm saying? Because something just told me. But she said, then I'll call these people and get you help. And that last night right there, I took and spent the last few dollars I had to do up that last little bit, you see. So when I went and started going into the outpatient, then I ended up moving in with her. And then I was going to outpatient, but she was going to meetings with me. She would go. But the only problem was you had triggers back then. That's what I had to learn what that was, triggers. If I seen money or someone smoke a cigarette or someone I know just walk by or someone I know smoke crack, here I come. You know what I mean? And especially if I got money in my hand, I couldn't hold it. So I went through that, you know, through that phase. And then she said, well, Mama, I think you need a 35-day program. I said, She said, You know, so I was like, but you know what? I didn't really fuss too much. So it had to be something I really wanted at that time. Because I really didn't like the life. I really was tired of it. And I really wanted like a normal life. So I went through the, you know, changes, went in the 35-day program and got out. Started working and stuff. But I slipped back a little bit. But what took me was the last time I moved in with my daughter. She said, Mama, you can stay here. She said, but if you're high, you're smoking crack, you can't come in my house. I thought she was joking. Are you for real? So I had a little money. I said, let me go buy my last little bit. And I came back to the house. She said, you be outside. You can't come in my house. I said, what? So I'm up there, got my stem, trying to smoke in the yard. Her husband out there working on the car. Bam, bam, bam. And when you hit this stuff, I'm just paranoid. I'm like, geez, I can't even enjoy this stuff. So I'm like, I got to go to the bathroom. I got to go to the bathroom. No, Mama. Go to the gas station. She would not let me in that house. So I said, you know what? I said, fine. I took that pipe and stuff I had, and I just took it and I crashed it on the ground. I said, no more. On that day, that was in 2007, just before Mother's Day. And I went in her house and never smoked again. So that's what I'm saying. It has to be, it's a process that we all go through of everything that we do. But it has to be something you want. Just like I say, when people, even in my Sunday school, you go to school and you want to graduate, you want to be a doctor, or you want to be a lawyer, or you want to be a mechanic, you're going to study, you're going to seek those things out to be the best you can be. So that's the same thing about God. If you want to be God, you see, I'm going to tell you something. Everybody said there's no joy, God is boring, but let me tell you something. Since I turned my life completely around and I gave God everything, I can sit back and I may not have money in my pocket.
Amen.
I might not have everybody next to me, a husband. I may not have, you know, my children just right there with me at all times or getting along with me. I might not have a friend that's always by my side. You see what I'm saying? But I got God.
Yes.
God is my source. And then I know when I go through, I say, Lord, I say, you know what? I say, I ain't got this and that. I say, but I'm happy. Because I don't have to be out there in that world no more. I don't have to let crack run me. I don't have to let alcohol direct me in other areas. I don't have to be out there with people like that. You see, now what I'm saying, this is what I'm saying, because people get this wrong. God said you don't supposed to hang with people that's not equally yoked with you. Just like I don't smoke crack, so what I look like going out there hanging with a crackhead out there in the street. I can be around them, I can have dinner with them, give them a word, and then I'm gone, you see? But that don't mean I put them down because of what they do. Or if you see someone drinking, oh, you need to come to church and repent. No, you don't judge that person. You cannot do that. You love them. And what I do, I befriend people. I befriend people on Facebook all the time. If y'all look on Facebook, I always got a son somewhere, especially the young men. They always looking for a mother because some of them don't have none. Some have them, but they in the village, they can't be where they are. You see, some don't lost both parents and they in orphanage, but they end up going to school because someone pays that money for them to go. But they don't have none. And every time I look over there in Africa or any of these other countries, in Brazil, all these different places, and Pakistan and all these places like that, they don't have the things in life that we have here. They don't have running water in their house. Half of them don't even have a bathroom in their house. You see, when they wash clothes, they go to the water and they wash them on rocks for real. This is no joke. People think that's just a saying. People think that, you know, but it's not. And when they eat their food, it's vegetables, whatever they grow from the ground. They don't have meat stuff like we do here. So this is what I'm saying, and when I tried to give them a little happiness, a little joy, even though it's on Facebook, yeah, son, I love you, mommy is here, but that's what they call you, mommy, you know, same as pastor do, that's the word they use. But I always be a mother to men, and I always say that because I mother anybody that wants a mother. Anybody that don't have, they may have a mother, but the mother ain't there, but like my son, he had a mother, but he didn't have a mother. You see what I'm saying? Even my daughter, even though I was out there in that world, just because I made sure they had clothes and had food and a roof over their head, but I still wasn't there as a mother should have been. I wasn't there at the time they needed me most, you see? But I didn't see that, you see? I went through problems at home, so I had a mother and father, but I didn't have a mother and father, if you know what I'm saying. You know, the things that went on, and I ended up leaving home. So this is what I'm saying. And then I had to think when I didn't used to forgive my mom for a lot of stuff. I blamed her. But when someone told me, said, well, just like you have problems and you want people to understand you and forgive you, what's your mama been through? What was your mom's life like? What did she endure through her life? And she was a only child. She had no brothers and sisters. She would have, but she seen her mother shot and lost the baby, could never have no more, was pushed down the stairs. So this is what I'm saying. You don't know what trauma anybody has been through. It can be your family, but when they leave your home and go out in a different life out there, you don't know the life that they're having because they don't tell you everything. So I'm just saying, you know, stop judging other people. Stop judging people in your family because they drink, because they do drugs, whatever. Be there for them. Even though, and I know what it's like. I can be there all day for them because I know the process I had to go through. It's not easy. It is not easy. It's a chemical imbalance when you try to come off those drugs and alcohol. You go through withdrawals. And then when I used to go through them withdrawals, I didn't understand them. They had to tell me so I could understand them. I went through plenty. And it's the way you act. It's your actions, how you eat. You get sick, all that. And so you got to think about where that person coming from. But all I'm saying is no matter what you go through, no matter what you endure in your life, hold your head up. If ain't nobody around, talk to God. He's all you really got. Ain't no one else going to help. Ain't nobody like Jesus. Ain't going to do you like he will. They're not going to love you like he love you. And they're not going to understand you like he understand you. And them songs this morning, boy, just went all the way around me this morning. Because it was like, praise God, you know, because I know what God can do. I really do. So basically, all this is the same thing, but it's just like, too, when we get down in the press, you know, and, you know, God encourages throughout his word every day. If you pick this word up, if you pick it up, I don't care if it ain't for 5 minutes, pick it up and read a word, because something God going to give you, and it's for you. But that's just like the same thing in Genesis 13 and 14, when God told Abraham to lift up his eyes and look around him in all directions. That's when his son was going against him so bad. And he felt like he just lost everything in the world. He had nothing in a strange place. So God said, stand up. Look to the north. Look to the south. Look to the east. Look to the west. All this I will give you. But see, people don't understand when God said he's going to give you something, that means you got to serve him. You can't go out there, drink alcohol, smoke crack, and expect God to bless you.
That's right.
You know what I'm saying? People say, oh, well, you always talk about all these blessings. You prophesy I'm going to get this and prophesy that. Well, what are you doing? What kind of life do you have? What kind of life are you living? What are you doing for God? I have someone tell me, God don't do nothing for me. I said, oh, he don't? I said, well, who woke you up this morning? Oh, my Lord. I said, are you in your right mind this morning? I said, are you walking on your feet? And all these blessings you got, see, people don't realize. They think they got to have money. They think they got to have big-time cars. They think they got to have a big-time home to be happy. That's not happiness, because guess what? They get burnt down. They rot out. They get old. The engine go down. The engine die. The tires bust. I mean, you know, all kinds of things go wrong with all these things. But guess what? God don't break down. God don't have flat tires. God don't have headache. God don't catch the flu. You know what I'm saying? We all get sick. We can't come to church. We can go private, but we can't get to church. We didn't go to a ball game, but we can't come to church. We tired. We got up late. But there was time, man, I used to stay up 24-7 all day, all night. So why not stay up 24-7 for God?
Yeah.
See, people don't see that. They don't see where they help really come from. And when we out there in the world like that doing those things, God covering us the whole time because he's saving us for a time. But when he calls you and you're not ready, and when he lifts that hand off you, you gone. You gone. And I'm gonna say this to say that people don't realize heaven and hell is real. And just like this man chose hell because he thought in hell he was going to be partying and having girls and, you know, just having a good time and not being able to have to do nothing. You know, he said heaven was boring. But guess what? When God sent him to hell, he burned. His skin burned so bad he burned and all he seen was fire. But I'm going to tell you the destruction here. When the tribulation comes, there's not going to be no law. No law. And I read some of that, but I've seen this in my own visions when I'm looking at.
Purgatory.
Yeah, that too. But I'm just saying, I see these things because I've read in the Word where he explains what hell's going to be like. And you just think of your flesh just burning. And, but the only thing, you ever burn your finger on a fire, or you burn your hand on a stove or an iron or something, you feel how that thing burns? Just think of your whole body burning like that. And I mean, and then what makes it so bad, it don't stop. But then the thing is, in the world in tribulation time, people are going to be killing worse than they kill it now. They're going to be bombs. They're going to be, and we already have that now, but it's going to get worse. That little riot thing they don't have, they got going on, oh, it's going to be worse than that. And all them buildings they burn up there, it's going to be worse than that. You think Ferguson bad, you wait till it all hit. And I tell you, when it hit Florida, it's going to wipe Florida out. And I'm going to tell you, if you don't have God in your life, you're in trouble. You're in very deep trouble. And this is something serious. And I'm going to tell you, and I feel in my spirit, it's going to be soon. This time, I used to always say, oh, he ain't coming yet. They keep saying this, you know. But now if you just look at everything, now I pay more attention to things than I did back then. Start paying attention. Listen to the news. Just start listening when your best friends are killed and your schoolmates are dying off. People getting illnesses they can't, just like this Ebola, they can't get rid of it. All these things. But see, over there, like they say in Africa, you got some and some do, some don't. But see, God's going to take care of his own. He's going to take care of what belongs to him. And he know if you belong to him or not. But if you end up catching one of them diseases and all that, then you must not belong to him. Because he's going to protect you. But I'm saying, it depends how you live in your life. Are you really living truly? Are you really being holy with your life? Are you really truly saved? Are you truly serving God? I kind of went off my subject a little bit, but it all runs together because I'm trying to really encourage you and to really, when you sing these songs too, give myself away. What are you giving away?
That's it.
Are you really doing it?
That's
right.
When
you get baptized, do you know what you got baptized for?
Right.
Do you know what it meant when you got baptized? Because now it's no more your life. You died.
That's it.
Your whole life died. And when you come up out that water, that's your new life. You're
yes.
resurrected
yes.
in Christ.
Yes.
So then you should be doing Christ-like things. You should not be doing this thing. And see, people say they can't do that, but you know, I found out when I did that Sunday at baptism, I can do it. and I feel good.
Amen.
That I don't, you know, I can keep my mouth shut. I feel good. I can humble myself, you know.
Yes.
And you don't realize it, but it's a joy. And then like you said, and you start saying that's when that joy was hitting me over here in this corner.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying? But it's a joy that you can't explain, but you just want to give it to everybody because you just can't keep it to yourself.
That's right.
You know
that's
what I'm
right.
saying? So this is what I'm saying. So when you, if you really, really, truly give your life up, really mean it.
Amen.
Really choose, you know, because once you start serving God, it's no more your life.
That's it.
I swear, and if you listen, you'll hear him. You hear what he has to say, and I hear him more now than I used to.
Amen.
Now he's starting to show me some things I never thought I'd
that's
see.
That's right. Amen.
You know what I'm saying? But he's using me.
Amen.
You see, and he's putting me, and I want to be in my destiny where God wants to take
yes,
me.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
I want to be the best vessel that I can be for him.
Yes, Lord.
I want to be able to put his word out there. I want to be able to lay hands and heal people. I want to be able to cast out demons. Because doesn't the word tell you we can do that?
You can do
all
it.
Of us can do that. But if you ain't right, and you got a flaw in there somewhere, and you got a stick in your side, well, that was... No. The thorn. Who was the one who had the thorn in his Elijah? Was it Elijah? Or Paul?
Paul.
Had that thorn.
Paul.
I couldn't get rid of that. I think yeah, Paul.
Paul.
I couldn't get rid of that thorn, you see. So everybody's got a thorn somewhere.
Yeah.
And I had a thorn. Them cigarettes was my big thorn. Boy, bye. Them cigarettes was sticking me back. You know what I'm saying? So this is what I'm saying. We all have a thorn somewhere.
Yes, Lord.
Get rid of that thorn.
Yes, Lord.
Understand what it is to serve God. Understand what he can do for you.
Yes, Lord.
It might not be a whole shot message, but I you know, I'm coming around,
it's
but
powerful.
It's like I have to give what God gives me.
That's
and
it.
It's in my spirit.
Amen,
to
amen.
Give this. And it's the songs, everything just went with it. The testimonies,
amen.
You know. So it's the faith that we have. And I'll be continuing to pray for your brother, too.
Yes.
Because I know God is good. And another thing I wanted to say, I have two lady friends. Sister Vance, that was here last week. Now, this woman, when she talking about being blessed, this woman done been through surgery. She done had her hair shaved off. She done went through brain surgery. She done had tumors in the brain. This woman really been sick for some years. And for me to still see her, I know God is able. And the lady, Sierra, Kathy Sierra, walking miracle. She's at Pastor Belvin's church, the bright skinned lady that had the brace. See, that lady came here with her daughter way back. Remember when Apostle prayed for her and them in here? Once you weren't here yet. You weren't here yet. I don't mean I first came back in here again when I first come back and she came here to a service and my apostle prayed for her and I seen this woman crying. She still have to use that brace every now and then, but this woman been in accident. This woman's been sick. And when I was talking to her, because she started writing me and I started talking, because I said, praise God, because I see what God can do. It's people like her that inspire me to know what God can do, you know. And I ain't had a big miracle in my life like that, you know, not death and stuff like that. Well, I guess the crack you could say death, but not like these people. I mean, on operating tables, you know, with brain surgery and tumors and things on the inside, cancer, and they, you know, God healed them. God has healed people from AIDS. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So this is what I'm saying. To see it, actually see it, God allowed me to see that, you see? So I could know what he can do.
Amen.
You know, sometimes he'll show us if we really looking and we really seeking out something about him, he's gonna show it to you.
Amen.
But I thank God every day because you know, people, you know, one time
there was
prophesied that the devil was trying to kill me. And he was trying to kill me with them drugs.
Mm-hmm.
But I thank God to this day because even when I was out there, I had no drug charges,
amen.
No felonies. I did get two prostitution charges, but they weren't bad, they were misdemeanors. But if I had got any more, then they would have been felonies. But I thank God because I didn't catch AIDS while I was out there.
Amen.
You know, I didn't catch all the illnesses, you know what I'm saying? And
amen.
I thank God for that. But I did catch one and didn't know, and I carried that thing for 3 years. Syphilis, I carried it 3 years. And I showed no signs. It lay dormant all that time. And then when I went in 2006 and went into the treatment center for a 30-5-day program, they found it. But then I was healed. You see what I'm saying?
Amen.
So God got a way of covering you and keeping you here to a point in time. Because, you know, there used to be people that didn't pay me no mind. Now I got everybody talking, speaking, calling me, pastor. I'm like, what? I'm minister. You know what I'm saying? Because you ain't used to that. And
amen.
People still do that, you
yeah.
know? So I thank God, and I want to be all I can be, and I'm seeking my destiny in Christ, Amen. Not in the world, in Christ, because with Christ, it's forever.
Amen.
In the world, it will die. Nothing lives long here.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen.